Okay, hi, I'm Daniel, and I'm going to talk to you about XMPP, a topic which I spent the last 2.5 years digging into. Well, let's go to the beginning. In the year 2005, about 10 years ago or so, I started to use this alternative to ICQ called XMPP. And then I got my first like real mobile phone running Symbian S60, and I discovered that, oh, I could even use XMPP on my mobile phone. And this was at a time when text messages were still like 19 cents or something like this. And well, this could save me a lot of money. And by the way, that's 2 years before WhatsApp came around. But a couple of years later, I got my first Android phone. At a time when Google had already did their first redesign called HoloUI or whatever, and the only available XMPP clients for that, well, they kind of looked like this, which, to be honest, not very nice, and they also had this annoying permanent notification by default. And so I wandered off a little bit of the XMPP world and started using Google Hangouts, which also did this nice sync with the browser thing that you can switch seamless between your mobile phone and your desktop. And I started to wonder what it would take to write a, well, nice looking chat client for Android, which doesn't use the permanent notification. And in early 2005, I did this UI mock-up, more or less, which has very strong resemblance to Hangouts at the time. I kind of basically, I've never did Android development before, and I saw it just from a UI perspective. I basically copied Hangouts, like bits by bits, like taking screenshots and measuring distance to get everything right, and using the color picker. And my sort of benchmark was if I can't tell the two apart, the two apps apart in the recent app overview, like when I get confused which one to select, then I got it right. And well, yeah, I basically got to this point where I had all this UI, and then I wondered, well, how hard can it be to teach this app to actually send messages? So, and this was the slides. That's awesome. this is when I started to dig into the extensible messaging and presence protocol, which is what XMPP means. And what I discovered is that it's well, basically XML streams, two of them, one incoming, one outgoing. And it basically has two types of XML elements, each with their payload. One group of them is called stanzas, which is basically like message presence and IQ elements. Which delivers the actual content. IQ stands for info and query, and is basically request response protocol within XMPP. All IQ messages require a response. IQ elements also have to have an attribute like ID, so I can identify the response when I receive it. And there's another group of elements which recently got relabeled to non-stars because they are not stanzas. Before that, they didn't have a name at all, which basically do stream control, like authentication or enable compression or a few other of them. We'll get to that later in the talk. And XMPP is extensible, these extensions are defined in so-called XEPs, which means the XMPP extension protocol. XMPP is a federated protocol, which means it's not only client-server, but also has server-to-server communication. All standard, remember, like presences, messages, and IRQs, are routable. They usually have to and from attributes. And entities within the XMPP network are identified by Jabber IDs, which can either consist of like email style username at domain dot something or just domain. And clients can also have multiple resources, which is useful if you want to connect with multiple clients at the same time. And then you get a resource string attached to it with a slash. And yeah, those resources are, meaning those different clients can set different priorities, usually integer values between minus 128 and 128. And so if I send a stanza to just the JIT, so just the Java ID, meaning username at server, they get routed to the resource with the highest priority. Except, of course, when resources have the same priority, then the server just picks one. And there are some exceptions for negative resources, which all of this is a little bit confusing. And you really don't want to teach your mom about like how priorities work and why the message you sent to their mobile phone didn't arrive at their desktop or something like this. The general idea behind this originally was, which worked pretty okay 10 years ago, is that you send the first message to the bare Jabber ID, and then the server would pick the resource it's routed to, which you hope is the right one. Then you respond from the full Jabber ID, and subsequent messages can then be sent to the full Jabber ID until, well, you close your chat window or something like this, was the original idea. But especially on the Android world, you don't have chat windows to close because, I know, long-living application and stuff like that. But yeah, thank God it's an extensible protocol and we do have extensions. There's one extension which basically solves the routing issue by simply copying in all messages that are incoming to all your resources. And this also works for outgoing messages, of course. And yeah, the XEP is currently a little bit vaguely defined for messages that are not like real text messages. They don't deliver actual content, but like more like meta information, like if someone is typing, or like the tick marks if you have received a message, or like read a message or something like this. But the XFS, the standardization committee behind XMPP is currently in the process of cleaning that up a little bit more and, well, defining the behavior. But even at this point, it basically gets the job done. I mean, you do get all your messages at all your resources, which is really what you want. But of course, this is only for resources that are currently connected. Well, if you turn your phone off for a short while, maybe if you're at the movies or something like this, you won't receive the messages. So thank God there's something called message archive management for this, which basically stores all the messages at the server. And a new client can access the entire history because it's stored on the server. And more importantly, clients that had been offline for a short while can receive the messages that have been sent in the meantime. Because otherwise, if my phone was down for an hour, I would only see the messages back at my desktop, which is locked in at home, and I don't want to wait to read all the messages till I get home. So this was what message archive management is for. Currently, it's a bit tricky to use because it relies on the timing. The only way I can avoid querying the entire archive is to tell the server, well, this is the last time I've seen a message from you, so please give me all messages from that point on. And especially with shorter timeouts, this of course requires the phone and the server to have a synchronized time, which might sound a little bit complicated in theory, but in practice, both modern smartphones as well as servers just synchronize their clocks. So I know, not an ideal solution, but it's working at the moment. More ideal solution would be to make the IDs messages identified with in the archive predictable or known to the user. This could work in two ways. Like for incoming messages, the message archive management component on the server could just inject the archive ID. And at a later point, I could, oh, this is the last message archive ID I received. Please give me all messages from that. But this still fails because I would receive all my outgoing messages. So the approach that is currently being discussed to solve this issue is to make the outgoing ID predictable in some way by combining the stream ID or something like this. Yeah, okay. And this will also solve a lot of duplication issues. I mean, if I query the archive now and I don't have the exact timing, I might get messages twice, and there's a little bit pain to deduplicate them. But yeah, having a global ID set by the server for each message will definitely solve these problems as well. But yeah, what I currently discuss is solutions I proposed until here are for desktop and mobile clients as well. But mobile clients do have a few more problems. Mainly, cell phone connections tend to drop out a lot. I mean, for example, a tunnel or areas where you don't have cell phone reception at all. Like sending and receiving via your 3G antenna consumes a lot of battery. There's a couple of issues to solve here. First of all, the unreliable connection, which we do have something called stream management, which basically adds another group of non-SAS, which controls the stream, and add a request and acknowledge mechanism into the stream. And basically what it does is that the server and the client just count the stanzas they've sent, the number of stanzas they've sent, and then I can acknowledge to the server, I received your 23rd stanza, or something like this, and it works the other way around as well. And Well, I can also use this to resume sessions when my cell phone connection dropped out entirely and the underlying TCP connection got replaced. I can use stream management to just resume a session where I've left it before. I can tell the server, well, my TCP connection dropped out, but I received 40 stances from you, so can we just return the session from that point, which makes the sending and receiving of messages both more reliable and also saves me a lot of traffic, because the bootstrapping code I have in a normal connection, like discovering my contact list and stuff like this, I don't have to do this again, because I've already done it in the stream on a later point. But the problematic thing from the server's point of perspective is that a server, of course, has to hold the state a client has. Like, here's your session and all you've done, and the stances which were sent to you in the meantime and stuff like this. So there has to be a timeout, of course, because a server cannot keep the state forever and just hope a user will come back at some point. So these streams will time out in some point. Usually it's about 5 minutes or so. And the problem is what happens with stances that were sent to me but not acknowledged by me, because I'm unable to resume a connection. And the only thing the server can do is to return the messages to the original sender and tell them, well, I'm sorry, but I couldn't deliver those messages, which is a bit annoying when we use stream management in conjunction with message archive management, because messages do get returned to the original sender, and the sender will then display it as, oh, sorry, delivery failed. But those messages are still stored in the message archive management, so reconnecting a client will still receive the messages. So it's just basically a useless error message shown to the original sender. There's currently no perfect solution for this. Sort of a workaround solution is to deliver all the messages that are not unacknowledged to the offline storage, and then at a later point, even clients that do not speak a message archive management would be able to receive the message. I know. Later solutions might include to make message archive management or something like this as a hard requirement, so sending entities can realize that the recipient will definitely receive the message at some point in the future. But there's still the problem of the high power consumption. You can imagine that every packet or every stance the user receives will wake up the user's battery. I mean, have a large roster with a lot of people like going offline, going online, or if I joined in a group chat in a kind of conference where people tend to go online and offline in really short intervals, like every minute or so. This will wake up my phone like every minute, which is really bad. And but I don't have any benefits from this as a mobile user, because when the phone is in my pocket, I really don't care who is currently joined in a conference or which of my contacts is online right now. I would only like to see this information, and I only need this information when I have the app in the foreground and actually are using this app. So there's an extension called client state indication, which basically allows the mobile user or the app to communicate to the server, I'm currently in the foreground or I'm currently in the background. And based on that information, the server is able to withhold unimportant information, like like those presence or online information, or which is also more or less annoying thing, these typing informations that are really, really temporary, and I don't get any benefits from, like, when my app would know that someone is typing, as long as my phone is in the pocket and I don't see the blah, 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 is typing information on screen. And yeah, we implemented this, and it really shows huge performance improvements concerning the battery life. We had users with 1,000 people in their roster or so, which came to me and complained, oh, your app is draining a lot of battery. And after me telling them, yeah, just enable this extension in your server, they came back and reported huge benefits. Okay, but we are in the year 2014 or 15, and we really want to be able to not only send text messages, but to also send like images or even like these short voice messages. Looking at ways you could send files with XMPP, or like file from one user to the other, there are currently two file transfer mechanisms in place. One of them is based on Jingle, which is a entire session initialization protocol stack, similar to SIP, for example, which is usually also used to initialize like voice calls or audio calls. And on top of that stack, there's also a file transfer implementation. But, well, you can imagine if there's an entire SIP stack behind it, it's very complicated to implement, or not really complicated, but it takes a lot of work to get right. And this is not really desired if you just want to send files. I mean, you don't need the entire, hey, I'm calling you now, and please let's use this codec for our video call or something like this. There's also an older mechanism called SE file transfer or SI file transfer in XMPP, which does have a few drawbacks, and it's pretty much outdated right now. The Standardization Foundation behind XMPP is currently discussing to officially deprecate that one. So, well, yeah, I did a Jingle implementation for my app, but only tuned for file transfer explicitly. I didn't implement the entire stack, but really tuned it to file transfer. But yeah, all of these approaches are peer-to-peer file transfer, and they don't work if you desire to use multiple resources. Because you always have to select which resource to explicitly send those image or this file to. And well, all of this is really complicated, and all we want to do really is just to send files, and there is an easier approach for this, which is also used by a lot of other instant messaging solutions. For example, WhatsApp does this, to just upload the files somewhere to the server, preferably like HTTP, for example, because it's a pretty easy protocol to use and it's implemented in a lot of places. And then you can just share the link to the file. And this automatically works with with multiple connected resources. It also sends you yourself a copy from your outgoing file, and it also works with conferences. I mean, if you don't have to send the file personally to every participant in a conference, it's much easier to just share a link. Well, I implemented this as a draft and also wrote my own extension for this solution, and this is currently under review by the Standardization Foundation. And yeah, all these combined gives us a pretty good modern instant messaging solution, which is completely on the same level as WhatsApp, for example, or Hangouts, which I had been using recently. But yeah, we are nerds, and we also are interested in what we call end-to-end encryption. And if you try to implement this, there are two approaches to look at. There's one solution called OpenPGP, which is the same one we do use in email, for example, or some people do use in email. The advantage is that it has a sort of standardization which describes this is how we used it in the past, so at least you can achieve some sort of compatibility with other clients. But it's OpenPGP. It has several drawbacks. It's, for once, it's very verbose because it's public key encryption. It has no verification built in. I know that OpenPGP itself can, of course, sign messages, but the current way it's used in the XMPP world doesn't do signing at all. It doesn't do perfect forward secrecy, and it's very prone to replay attacks. If you don't have a signage, you can just copy a message and send it again to the user if you're a malicious server, for example. Which, especially in the instant messaging context, is a pretty big problem, because you tend to send very short messages, and if you imagine you can access the entire history from someone and rebuild all the messages in a different order, you can, I don't know, create basically whatever context you like if you're a little bit lucky. The only advantage of this and the sole purpose I implemented this in the first place is that it does work with multiple resources, as well on the sending side and on the receiving side, which is something the off-the-record encryption does not do. I mean, OTR is protocol agnostic, and well, it's pretty much the definition of end-to-end, and end-to-end encryption implies sort of that it's, well, one user or one device to another device. But yeah, it is state-of-the-art encryption, so encryption-wise, it's much better than OpenPGP. Unfortunately, it really is annoying in a mobile context, because it has synchronous sessions, meaning I have to establish a new session every time I want to start a new conversation, meaning I have a round trip time between it. Like, hey, let's implement a session. Okay, here's my key, and then you can send encrypted messages. And if those establishing connections somehow get lost in the process because one device wasn't offline or wasn't online or something like this, it gets in the way of this. Also, of course, it requires both parties to be online at the same time, which is also not really good, because I want to send a message to you now and not, I don't know, I don't want to wait on you. I implemented this as well and did some kind of workaround for this. where I would have one client store the message on behalf of the user and then wait for the other client to come online and then send the message. And at least I have the benefit of typing the message, forgetting about it, and then hopefully in some point in the future when both devices are online at the same time, the messages get sent. And, well, like I said, we are in a world where we use multiple devices at the same time, and this was the entire purpose I started this project and started to dig into XMPP. And so what we really want, basically, is multi-end to multi-end encryption, which means a message I send from one device automatically shows up on my other device, meaning my desktop or my tablet, and shows up on all four devices of my contact, whatever, whatever you want to use four devices. But thanks to the Google Summer of Code, we just implemented this, and we call it OMIMO, the multi-end message and object encryption. And this allows you basically to send an encrypted image to an offline contact who uses two devices, and you also simultaneously get a copy of that message on all your connected resources. And we packed this in a really easy user experience where you would just select OMIMO as an encryption method, trust the devices you want to send those messages to, and it just works. Now with multi-end to multi-end encryption, you have a new problem which just hasn't been there before, that you could theoretically receive messages from a new device, which both could be a completely legit case, because your contact just got a new phone or reinstalled the app on its phone, or it also could be a malicious attacker which just wants to insert messages into your message stream. And so what our UI does is marks those messages and then guide you to either trust this device or don't trust this device, or I don't know, let you make this decision at a later time when you meet this contact in person and compare fingerprints. As far as the technical background is concerned, we use Axolotl, the same protocol that is used in TextSecure, which is kind of a more modern variant of OTR, which uses a little bit better crypto. It uses elliptic curves. But more importantly, it gets rid of the session initialization. Instead, it keeps long-running sessions that can be kept, like, I only need to establish them once, and then I keep them basically forever. And it also takes care of like lost messages or reordered messages. So this is what we use in the background. And we basically create axolotl encrypted sessions between every device combination, then send a random key over those sessions and then encrypt the message with those key. So we have to send the message only, the actual message only once, and just share the keys with the devices. But the multi-end to multi-end approach kind of shifts the approach that you are not trusting users, but you trust devices, because, this is what you have. You have to trust each individual device. But to make the UI really simple, most current multi-end to multi-end encryption, like TextSecure, for example, or WhatsApp, use this trust on first use approach. But this, of course, doesn't work because we get new devices like every time, and simply trusting them each time would entirely defeat the purpose, because a malicious attacker could just create a new device and inject it there. So instead, what the UX or UI we chose for this is to display a message to the user saying, oh, your contact got a new device, or you yourself got a new device. In the background, it uses XMPP technology, so there's no server changes on the server required. For example, it stores the keys or the pre-keys on the XMPP server using PEP. I don't want to get into this, but it's the same mechanism that also powers avatars, for example, basically storage on the server. Okay, but there are still a few problems left that I haven't been able to address with my own client. XMPP, of course, does have a way to communicate with multiple users at the same time. It's called multi-user conference, and it's very ERK-like. You have it's even more complex than ERK. You have all the roads you know from ERK, like voice moderator, and it has moderated conference and private conferences, and it can kick and ban users. But the main problem is that you have to join a multi-user conference on every session. You cannot subscribe to it. Each time you connect with a device or you create a new session, you have to join, and you're only actually part of the conference as long as you're joined, meaning you don't really receive messages that have been sent when all of your clients were offline. And concerning the encryption we do want to use at some time in the future, another drawback with multi-user conference is that you don't have access to the member list, meaning you only know the nickname a user has in a conference and not the true identity behind it. So you are unable to access basically the public keys of the user. So what we actually want is a more simpler approach, a more closer approach to what WhatsApp or Hangouts does, which is simple group chats. A couple of friends want to just share the same chat and send messages to each other at the same time. But unfortunately, this doesn't exist yet. The Standardization Foundation does have a general consent that something like this should exist in the near future, and the general idea that powers this is that you join a group chat once with one of your clients, and from that point, all your clients receive all messages every time until you might explicitly leave at some point in the future. It also probably will avoid the NIC stuff the multi-user conference has, and instead exposes the true job IDs of each member, and so you can have direct relations to, oh, this user are in a conference, and those are the same users that are in your roster, and you can see their avatars or access their encryption keys. This is basically the next thing I want to take on and solve this problem, which for me is basically the last problem remaining in the XMPP world. And yeah, until then, you are free to have a look at my client, which I regard as, well, a state-of-the-art XMPP client for Android. You can have a look at the source code, which is on GitHub. It's also available on Google Play. And if you're more interested in our new encryption message or MIMO, you can check out the Google Summer of Code blog. The student scientist did an amazing job, and well, I think this encryption is really where the future lies. Thank you. Okay, question. Go ahead.
Do you have any plans to copy the newest version of Hangouts in regards to the Eclipse
page? Yeah, the question was if I want to adapt to the new way Hangout looks now, because when we go back to what the screenshot I originally showed there, this is how Hangouts looked 2 years ago and not how it looks today. I started off by copying Hangouts bit by bit, but I feel like I started to develop my own design language and find my own niches and my own concepts, and yeah, I'm pretty happy with this. Okay, next one. I think the question was if you want to integrate Omimo in group chats. Of course, yeah. The accept for this is currently in the work. It's nearly done, and we will probably publish it within the next 24 hours on this domain, basically. we didn't finish this off to the conference, but yeah. It's, yeah, the group chat one is in the really early stages of development right now. There has been talks on the last XMPP summit, which was at the same time as the FOSDEM in Brussels. I wasn't at the conference myself, so I know only what like people are telling me. But yeah. I haven't really looked into that much, but I will starting now, basically. Any more questions? Okay. Yeah, just go ahead. Right one.
I wanted to ask about the HTTP file button. Where did you find the server
actually? Yes, the question was where do the files in the HTTP upload get uploaded to. You basically communicate with the server and tell your own server, please give me a URL. And where this URL is fully agnostic to the protocol. I mean, if I've published a Python component on GitHub, which you can install on your own HTTP server if you use your XMPP server only for a few users and just have the files uploaded to the same server, but you also could use, for example, cloud storage like Amazon S3. You can communicate basically every random URL or whatever you like. But exactly, yes. But the idea is that the timeout values are either roughly equal to message archive management, so the server operator chooses equal amounts of time there, or, yeah. But yeah, you're right, there's no direct link between them. Yes. Okay, next one. Yes, the question was regarding privacy concerns with the HTTP upload. And well, we do can use encryption on that. OMIMO is defined as the message and object encryption, meaning OMIMO can also encrypt files. And I have also implemented a proprietary OTR file encryption, which I already use when sending files over Jingle. And I use the same, basically, IIS encryption to encrypt the file before I upload it to HTTP, and then communicate the key for the file out of band in my encrypted OTR or OMIMO session. And if I use PGP as an encryption message, of course, PGP is basically not really made for encrypting files, but usable for encrypting files. Yes? Yeah, sure. Yes? Yeah, the question was about hijacked sessions in OMIMO. Well, there's no way for myself to invalidate my own sessions once the device got stolen. But as long as I still have a secure channel to my contact, I can tell that contact to purge the session and just remove it from their devices. Building a kind of revocation process in there. I mean, it doesn't work for TLS or certificates in the browser. Why would it work there? So. Okay, more questions? Go ahead.
Is there sort of a cool hangout feature, meaning storing all messages, so the complete log, all messages on the server, so a new device, new client may see the complete conversations?
Yeah. The question was if there's a complete archive on the server. There is it. It's called message archive management. But of course, this doesn't work in conjunction with encryption, because you trust device sessions, and well, that device didn't exist before, so it cannot access the history in the past. But for unencrypted sessions, if you are fine with for unencrypted messages, it works perfectly fine. I can set up my new Android tablet right now and access my entire history from the last 2 years or so. Yes? Which one, the message archive management?
Yes,
this is a server extension, yeah. Both the server and the client would have to support message archive management. Yes, Ozzy, the question was if I can give an overview which servers implement the accepts I've talked here. And both ProSID and eJabberD in recent versions support all of this I'm talking about here. I'm using, or a lot of conversations users do use ProSID and eJabberD. OpenFire, which is a popular server because it's easy to set up, especially in small offices and stuff like this, is currently trying to catch up, I would describe it. They haven't been doing the stream management, for example, and neither the message archive management, but I was told they will in some point in the future. Okay, more questions? Yes.
The usual problems with encryption, especially in IAM, is that only a small percentage of users are encrypting, and some of them are using BGP, some of them OTR, and some of them are using OME modes. There is it foreseeable that there will be an agreement that in the near future everyone will join on the one part?
Yeah, the question was about the there are so many different encryption methods that are all incompatible to each other. And well, with conversations, you're sort of in luck because conversation supports all three of them. Well, the kind of agreement, at least I would say, with reasonable people in the XMPP world is that both PGP and OTR are not really good because of the drawbacks I described earlier. And I kind of hope people will implement Omima in the future because, well, this is basically what you actually want. And, well, a couple of client developers were already interested in implementing this themselves in the process of creating this. So, yeah, we can hope. Yeah.
For which kinds is Omima already implemented?
We just did the implementation in conversation as a proof of concept, basically, as part of the Google Summer of Code, which ended yesterday. So right now, none, unfortunately. But yeah, you could use conversations with Arc Welder and Chromium on your desktop if you are really into this. But yeah, we all hope for actual implementations in the near future. Okay, more questions? Yes, over there.
So when you
in-band, the encryption itself is it's in band, yes. Yeah, like I said, the question was if there's if a file transfer is in band and if there's a size limit. Well, we do upload files encrypted to HTTP. This is our approach to it. But if you look back to what other clients would do in the past, Jingle file transfer can negotiate both chunked in-band transfer because a normal file would be too big, so it's getting split into several messages, and out-of-band file transfer where I open a SOX connection directly to the other device and send the file in binary, basically. Okay? Any more? No? Doesn't look like it? Oh, there. Yeah. Yeah. Well, the question was which desktop client I would recommend. It depends on what you are after. If you are basically after the message synchronization for unencrypted messages, that you want to switch seamless between your mobile client and your desktop client, the only real thing you would have to look out for is Carbon support, which I mentioned very in the beginning of my talk, which copies the messages to every device. There are a couple of clients which do Carbon support, Gudgeon, for example, or if you're a fan of the command line, there's mcover, which I personally use. If you're into file transfer, well, if your sending client is conversations, it will just send an HTTP link, so that will work with every client. If you want to send a file from your desktop client to a mobile device, then you are probably better off with Gudgeon because it does the Jingle file transfer. And there are also plugins in the works which do HTTP file upload for Gudgeon. Or, yeah, if you're kind of, I don't know, in the mood for it, you can also try conversations in Arc Welder, as I mentioned before. That will give you all the features. But, yeah. Okay. More questions? Yeah, I guess not. So, yeah, thank you.
Thank you.